we're ready to start the evening. It's a great pleasure to welcome Andrew Freear from the rural studio in the U.S. back to the AA, a school he knows and has lectured at in the past and is familiar with as a former student of this place. Andrew's talk tonight coincides with the rural studio's exhibition and presentations at the RIBA this week as one of the winners of a program titled Emerging Visions, a worldwide competition of young and emerging practices that have been given the opportunity to present their work here in London and share it with the community in the UK and in Europe. I think when the RIBA set up a program like that, they probably hadn't quite imagined a place like the rural studio, which for an emerging vision is a remarkable group of people, in part because they've probably built more buildings already than most architects get the chance to think about in a lifetime. Since the studio was set up in 1993, they've designed and built literally hundreds of projects around the rural county, Hale County in Alabama, in the Americans, deep in the American South. And I think it's interesting in part because it's really not in any way an office or a practice as we understand it. In fact, part of the genius of the rural studio is, of course, that underlying it all is a remarkable optimism and belief in architectural pedagogy as its own form of reinvention and rethinking. The design-build program that the rural studio is built upon demands of its students, as many of you know, not just the design, but the realization of projects over the course of an academic year. And I think tonight would be a good occasion to remember that the second year students that are a part of this project have, in addition to the portfolio demands of June, the expectation that their visitors will be walking into the projects that same month. And in fact, it happens every year. And we're incredibly lucky that Andrew is able to take a bit of time to come join us and show us some of the results of that work. It's an incredibly, incredibly optimistic program in its belief, not just in what students are able to do, but what's possible by architects today. That optimism stems out of the original vision of Samuel Mockbee, who set up the program in 1993 and brought together a group of remarkable collaborators who do the teaching and thinking alongside this group of students every year that come into the course. Mockbee's famous quote, which is written early on in the development of the program, turned everyone's attention to, as he said, the demands that any architects face today, whether they're in the American rural South or in the capitals of places like Europe and the UK, to not be overly awed by the accelerating development of technology and the proliferation of affluence, but that in the end, the real challenge is to connect architecture back to people and places. That's what the rural studio has been built around and continues to evolve as a center of its energy. Andrew is the co-director right now of the rural studio, the program that he directs with Bruce Lindsay, and has been working at now for several years in Alabama. The rural studio is famous in part for the ways in which it brings together all kinds of support to achieve these projects in a very short period of time, and increasingly publishing and exhibiting and presenting work in occasions like this evening, literally around the world. And one of the great twists on the story, taking rural America to the capitals of and world cities all over the globe today. Please join me in welcoming Andrew Freear.
Can you all hear me?
It works, yes.
I am extraordinarily nervous tonight. I don't know what it is about this building, but I met Anderson Inge down in the bathroom, which apparently is the place that we always meet. And it's not on. Oh, it's not on. That's why you can't hear me. Can you hear me? Oh. Can you hear me now? Yeah, this is I don't know what it is. I do plenty of presentations in other places, but to come back into this building, I literally 15 minutes ago was walking around outside, just really not able to come back in. It was always, and I was kind of trying to figure out what I was going to say to Brett. So I'd like to thank Brett and, of course, the AA for the invitation. I'm honored to be here. Looking at y'all's lecture series this year, just it's incredible what has been put together for y'all. You're all the luckiest people in the world to have so many opportunities to hear about stuff. It's incredible. I'd also just like to say some personal thank yous to Tim McFarlane and Martina for putting me up the kind of Hotel McFarlane, as I call it, every time I come to London. Tim also engineers some of our buildings, as does Anderson Inge, sitting here up at the front. So some of these things they're a little bit to blame for as well. And I acknowledge two or three of our students, our alumni, are here. Paul Carduce is here, and Amy Holtz, and where's Hannah? Actually an English student, can you believe? So I will stop rambling and talk about this guy, big fat white guy from Mississippi called Sambo Mockbee, a remarkably politically incorrect name, of course. When I went to the United States, in fact, actually, I should tell you that I got Tim McFarlane to, I kind of hooked him and Sambo up in New York to meet each other. And of course, Tim was absolutely and utterly astonished at the fact that Sambo was a white guy, as he expected a black man to be meeting him. So of course, I think for me personally, the term Sambo had kind of not particularly wonderful connotations before I turned up in Alabama. But to meet a man of that name, change that name into something that became a kind of a wonderfully warm part of my heart. He was a remarkable human being. I don't think I've met anybody who had so many close friends as this guy. It was like the instant that you met him, there was a warmth and a welcomingness to him that I've never met in anybody else anywhere. And I spent like 3.5 years living with him. So he was in private practice with Coleman Coker. And they kind of flitted between, essentially we were based out of Mississippi, and at some point in his career in the Deep South, they became very well known, but frankly, Sambo was not making any money. He had 4 kids, 3 of them were going to university, and the opportunity to go to Auburn University, he was given a distinguished professorship and all of that stuff, and he jumped at the opportunity. And he got to the university and decided that he didn't like the hallowed halls and was frankly bored, I think, and so he sort of searched out an opportunity to, I guess, not exactly create something new, but to take himself away from the campus and set up this program. And the program is actually, it's 3 hours away from the university, and he did that. He essentially did that 13 years ago, and with very, very little support. I mean, really, he ran the program right at the very beginning off his own credit card. And he didn't have the kind of support that I have now. And when people ask me, how do you do the Rural Studio? How do you set it up? Well, it takes someone with his magnetic personality and energy and desire and pure bloody-mindedness and stubbornness to go out into the middle of nowhere with a bunch of 22-year-olds and stay there. And pursue it, and it's an amazing thing that he did, frankly. 8 years ago, he got leukemia, and 4 years ago, he died. And it was an incredible shock because he was actually 4 years into remission. We thought he was well. He was running around like a 10-year-old. I mean, it was amazing. I was having to just pick up behind him. It was extraordinary energy that he had. I think that. One remarkable thing just happened a couple of years ago in that the AIA gave Samuel Mockbee and in effect the Rural Studio the gold medal. And for those of you who don't know the AIA, the American Institute of Architects, it's a pretty wonderful wonderfully conservative organization, and it's actually a pretty remarkable, I think, tribute to him that they actually decided to go ahead and give that award. And what I hope they gave it for was the kind of the critique that is brought to architectural education. I asked the question about how it is that we learn and how we teach, and also just to the whole idea of how do you make and procure architecture. And I hope that, you know, wherever the conversation is had, that it does provoke us into a question of how do we do what we do. And for that, I think it's a terrific honour to him and for his persistence in what he did. I hope that, you know, when Sambo died, before Sambo died, we talked a lot about what this education was about, and he used the term the education of a citizen architect. And that I felt, and he felt, was for an architect and for a student to understand their broader role in society. So I hope that what we bring to the table is sort of an attitude. It's not necessarily, we're certainly not trying to save the world, but it's a certain attitude towards an architect's role in society. And I think he believed in that deeply. He believed that if you were going to go ahead and get yourself an education, that you're not only bettering yourself, but you're actually bettering society. I should just also say that 4 years ago when he died, Ben Nicholson called me up and said, "Andrew, you've got to get the hell out of there." Because he very frankly thought that it was going to turn into Taliesin West. And this guy, quite honestly, he has been deified. I mean, you go to American ACSA, American Collegiate, basically the kind of forums for academics in America, and this guy is just God, and it's outrageous, it's ridiculous. I mean, the guy was a good guy, but he's certainly not, just ridiculous. But my response to that was, well, in all honesty, I didn't think it was at all possible that it would end up as Taliesin West. I mean, to understand the nature of the Royal Studio, the students, it's like running an office and your entire office changes every August the 22nd. The next group coming in is desperately trying to do something absolutely, completely, utterly opposite of what they did, the last group did. So Mockbee's genius was actually holding the hands of these people and saying, "It's okay, it'll be all right, just keep going." And it was a phenomenally optimistic, like you said, a really optimistic and very opportunist education that he offered the students. What I hope to do tonight, I've been involved with this thing for 6 years. I hope to give you kind of a little bit of an insider's view of it, but also a reasonable kind of outsider's critique of it as well. I'm going to take you on a kind of a hopefully a kind of fast journey through Hale County. I want you to see the place, I want you to see the people, and I want to see that context for in which the decisions are made. And hopefully you'll begin to learn a little bit of the process that we undertake. Because I think, you know, there's lots of fancy magazine articles about the Royal Studio and showing the kind of sexy objects that we make. But to be honest, that's about 1% of the real story. The real story is the education that our students get in the making of these things, and that's what I personally am most proud of. I have some grown-up things that I need to say, so I write them down. So I'll read a few things, and then I'll kind of ad lib, if you don't mind. And there's one prerequisite for this lecture. If you all don't laugh at my jokes, you can all bugger off now, okay? So, the Royal Studio is an undergraduate educational program that's part of the 5-year BArch at Auburn University, and it's now in its 13th year. It was set up by D.K. Ruth and Samuel Mockbee as a response to two things. There was a desire to have a more hands-on approach for architecture students, and also an interest in exploring the definitive royal house. I guess that at this point, before I go show you more of Hale County, I should give you all a quick geography lesson. This is the good old United States of America, which you all seem, at least your Prime Minister seems desperately wants to be the kind of the purple one down here, I think. And you can all boo and hiss if you wish, but I live over here in the beautiful pink state of Alabama. And you can, it speaks volumes about Alabama to suggest, to show you that at some point in their history, they sold that piece of property off, which is the richest and most valuable piece of property, of course, it could possibly have. But the other thing that you should notice is the Appalachian Mountain Trail. And it has a huge effect on our everyday lives, because part of this trail, part of this mountain and the geology of this area is the kind of the dirt that we stand on. What is the material that we stand on? And it's essentially a kind of a very expansive red clay. And it's known as, and it gives the name of a region, the Black Belt. Sorry, the AA has deliberately put all this obstacle course in front of me so I can't speak. It's known as the Black Belt, and it's not because there's a whole bunch of black folks there, it's because of the nature of that dirt, which is terrible to build on, but it's incredibly rich, and it obviously it pervades the cotton crop, and now it actually pervades catfish ponds for other reasons. But that's where we are, that's the name of the region. When you begin to focus in on that map, we live in this civil rights triangle, essentially, Montgomery, Selma, and Birmingham. And anyone that knows any little history of the United States of America in recent past and of the civil rights struggles, obviously this is a very profound region for us to inhabit. And we deal with it every day. It's absolutely in our faces every day. The other thing that's kind of wonderful about this map is it shows very graphically. I live in Newbern over here, which is a town of 200 people, and the great institution of Auburn University is 3 hours away in East Alabama. And that's huge, actually. That I cannot tell you. If you all want to set up a rural studio, you've got to get as far away from the mothership as you possibly can, so that provosts and chancellors and vice principals and all those boring people that want to stop you doing anything actually interesting, they leave you alone. Or at least, you've at least got 3 hours notice before they show up. You know. So you can carefully choreograph the... it's a shame, though, that the campuses have become so incredibly corporate. And I go back to the campus and I see the kind of corporate ideology. You can't even stub a cigarette out on the sidewalk anymore, let alone build prototype housing. So it's definitely a smart move if you want to do something like that. The chosen location, Hale County, Alabama, is an area that's well documented by James Agee and Walker Evans in the 1930s. They were essentially sponsored by the government to go down there. And what they brought back, what they returned with, really stunned people. Not immediately, because the book became kind of obscure, but eventually people were just blown away by its contents. And what you'll see is that very little has changed. This is Greensboro. I actually live in that apartment there, right in the top floor of that apartment. One of our students actually renovated it and I took it over. But that's Main Street Greensboro, and this is Main Street Greensboro today. And as you can see, apart from some yellow stripes down the middle and some automobiles, not an awful lot has changed there. And the same can be said about the essentially the poor side of town. This is a sharecropper's home circa 1930s. And this is Mason's Bend, West Alabama, most recently. And but, if Mockbee, and obviously when everyone shows up to these lectures, they're all kind of desperately disappointed to hear an English voice and not a kind of a sexy southern accent. And Mockbee at this point would start banging his chest and probably people around him, because it really, it led him to despair, quite honestly. There are, in Hale County, Hale County is the second poorest county in the second poorest state in the United States of America. 16,000 people, right? 45% of that populace live below the poverty line. An astonishing 54% of the kids under the age of 4 live below the poverty line. I mean, what the hell is that about? You know, this is a country that is blasting the hell out of small countries around the world. but in its own backyard can't really deal with its own poverty. And that really upset him. I mean, he was no evangelist, don't get me wrong, but I think that he was kind of interested in bringing this to people's attention just simply because of the hypocrisy of it.
Obviously, you know, Hale County is a very beautiful faith-based place, and religion is absolutely everywhere. There's evidence of great old wealth, and this is all the cotton wealth, essentially. But there's also incredible poverty, and this is what I was talking about. This is actually Lucy Harris's former house, and she was lucky enough to get a house that we built for her later on. But that's the kind of image of West Alabama that we deal with daily. But there's also amazing dignity, and this is Alberta Bryant, and this is Shepherd Bryant, her husband, and unfortunately last summer, two summers ago, this old guy died, and she is barely kicking around, quite honestly. She's lost both her legs because of diabetes, has a pretty terrible diet, but just somebody with just amazing, absolutely amazing dignity. Could not, you know, is it possible, are these two microphones on? I'm hearing myself or rattling or something. Is that better? Thank you. No, not really. But anyway, she has the greatest sense of humour, loveliest, warmest woman. If you ever go visit this woman, there's nothing less or more that she can do for you. She's just a terrific lady, and a fantastic sense of humour. This last Valentine's Day, I took a whole bunch of Valentines over there for her, and she, you know, she uses this. She kind of uses, and it's interesting, Hursley got the false leg in the photograph kind of deliberately, because when I first went to Rural Studio and met her, she was kind of guiding, you know, she was using it on the nephews and nieces, a kind of a stick to kind of, you know, beat them into place and make sure that they weren't going to get themselves out of order. So that was the weapon of choice in West Alabama at that time. Since the demise of the cotton, it's also a landscape that barely sustains a logging industry. And more recently, we've turned towards the catfish. Now, this is a Laird Cole. He's a dairy farmer. There was logging. Obviously, most of the rich forestry that was in Alabama has pretty much disappeared. All the hardwoods have gone. And there's softwood farming, but also dairy farming. And Laird is, we were very, very proud a couple of years ago because Laird became West Alabama Young Farmer of the Year. And Laird had desperately been looking for a wife and kind of was always sniffing around our second year students, wanting to know what was going on. And everybody is now thoroughly relieved because he got himself on the kind of the front of the equivalent of Farmers Weekly. And some gorgeous woman in Kansas saw this and actually managed to track him down. Can you believe it? They're getting married now. He's done it. So we're, you know, he's the greatest, this guy. He's one of the hardest working guys. But the real point of this slide, I guess, without you, this is a catfish pond. They're very easy to procure. They essentially go out there with a big old bulldozer and you dig a hole. You fill it full of water and you fill it full of catfish and a whole bunch of chemicals, and you've got yourself a big old catfish pond. And they diversify to survive. And who am I to kind of critique their way of life? Because it's really about survival down here. This is not making a lot of money. This is only just barely breaking even. But you know, one of the hardest working men. And just to the next slide is just to show you. This is a seining net. This is how they clean it. They take the fish out of the ponds, and you'll see that in one of the next projects. Now, just as an outsider, when I came to Hale County, there were a number of kind of, I mean, you know, this is a small plantation called Folsom. It's sort of 6 or 7 miles due east of us, and it has these remarkable remnants from the plantation that just kind of, I mean, I just find it extraordinarily beautiful. This is a little This is a little, essentially sort of a silo. It's a grain silo. And kind of lovely evidence of African carpentry in here. It was built by the slave workers. But as architects, it's like we'd just die for that cantilever. I mean, it's just a gorgeous thing, you know? And again, the big roof, you know, it's what we try to learn from out here is you protect the wall and protect the foundation. The thing's going to last for 150 years, even if it's built of wood. So,
there's stuff that delights.
I mean, I dress like a slob every day, 7 days a week. I'm a 24-hour-a-day slob. At least in Hale County, the folks, the belief and their religious persuasions, I think are a small part of what Sunday means to people, but I think that they actually also just enjoy dressing up, kind of being civilized, that Sunday is a different day, it's not a work day, and it means a day to be with the family. And I think that's a wonderful thing to have, and I admire that deeply. I don't really have that in my life, and I think that these folks are actually kind of lucky to have that.
Now, there's stuff that kind of, you know, this is Jim Witherspoon. I actually have played pool with Jim Witherspoon in the past.
He's a lineman for a local power company. And this is a scan of a photograph that was posted in the local gas station, because this is a 14-point bookhead, and that's a big deal. This is a real trophy. This one, okay? So
none of this Arsenal versus Chelsea business. This is
the big deal.
So that's the kind of landscape that Mockbee brought the students into. There's a good deal of deforestation.
Alabama, 95% of Alabama is owned by people who don't live in Alabama. Most of that property is owned by paper companies, and that's a huge deal. We have had recent referendums to raise property taxes to help education, and the paper companies with their incredible political influence come down really heavy, and nothing happens. So Alabama's in this incredible spiral. You can't raise property taxes, you can't help education. We're screwed. The other thing is that this is it, and the reason I show this slide is this is essentially low-income housing, which is essentially all the housing in West Alabama. The genius of this is it's financing. You can go to a local parking lot, a used car lot, or you can go to a trailer lot, and you can pick up one of these things, essentially put a down payment, and then pay extraordinary finance charges. So over 20 years, I might own this thing, but I'll probably have paid four or five times the amount that it's actually worth. And in 20 years, of course, there's this kind of built-in degradation with this thing that by 20 years later, it's worth nothing. So they've got them in this lovely cycle. They can't improve their education, and they live in these kind of, you know, sealed-up boxes. So as an architect, I can't be that. I can't give somebody a house that they can drive away tomorrow. So you can understand why they go for it. I will quickly run. Quickly run you through where the rural studio lives, and then I'll show you some of the projects, more particularly the later projects, as I'm sure you've fed up of seeing some of the earlier ones. But I would suggest that rural studio gives really three extraordinary opportunities to students. One is the experience of an arts and crafts-based education to really understand the implications of the drawn line and the connection between the drawn line and actually what you make, and vice versa. The other is an opportunity to go and live in a small town, a small town of 200 people, because typically our students are from either urban environments or suburban environments, and this is completely new to them. It's not only new to me, but it's very new to them as well. And then the last thing, and I think one of the most terrific things, is that we work in teams. It's all about teamwork. It's all about negotiation. And it's kind of fun for me, because they go through their education as kind of tortured artists, and we are the best, and we can do everything the best, and we can do it all. And of course, we end up being able to do it all very badly. So we encourage them to kind of begin. I mean, it's kind of refreshing for them to understand that it's okay if this guy over here is a good speaker, he can present the work. And if this guy's great on the computer, which he is, he can do the drawings. And it's, you know, that's okay. Because I think that it, and it really encourages them to work as a team, and they kind of have to negotiate that. And we enjoy that. I'll tell you later. So this is Morissette. This was actually given to the Royal Studio by an Alabama alum, which is kind of a minor miracle in its own right, because Alabama hates Auburn so much, it's kind of confusing as to why somebody would do that. But this is where the second year women live. It has jacuzzis and saunas and hot tubs and everything. It's just an incredible lap of luxury. And then the guys live out in the backyard. So they don't really have jacuzzis or saunas. There's jokes in there, just if you were. This is the super shed. The guys live in the pods underneath the super shed. This is where the second years live. You've got to provide accommodation if you want students to come out there. And these were early thesis projects. They're a terrific opportunity for students to come out and test some ideas. And you know, obviously they didn't have the opportunity to do these kind of mega things that we're doing today, but they had the chance to do these things. And I think they're okay. But it does, they look a little bit like what they are, which is, you know, I've been at school, architecture school, for 5 years. Here's everything I've learned. And I'm gonna literally vomit it out, you know.
But they work, and it's accommodation for us, and it doesn't hurt poor people, and, you know, it's fine. And then down at the end of the super shed is the composting, couple of composting toilets and a shower, and so it's pretty basic. And then there's a kitchen under here. This is the corner of one of the composting toilets, and it's actually covered in Hale County license plates, and they're pretty nice. They're put on in reverse, and it Mockbee always used to say that he thought that Gary had seen this idea before he did the Guggenheim. I think he's this is prettier, I can tell you, and a damn sight cheaper as well. This is where the faculty live. There's an early photograph of our faculty. It's up the road. This building was essentially given to us for $3,000, and we renovated it. And our presence in Newbern tries to be as discreet as it's possible to be. We don't have big signs. We want it to be Newbern. We don't want it to be a kind of an extension of Auburn or the Royal Studio. We try and be respectful to a community that's been there 150 years. But it's hard when you've got, you know, 28 testosterone-filled 22-year-olds driving around in SUVs. So you've got to be as discreet as you can. This is downtown. This is where our studio is, where the students design and work together. This is what we call the Red Barn. On Mockbee's death, I said, right, we've got to. There was no longer the studio had expanded to 28 students, and there was no longer kind of an opportunity to get around the dinner table together. And I said, well, let's get us at least in the same building so we can design together. And I went and asked the landlord about this, and he said, yeah, you can have it, but please don't change the exterior. And I'm like, well, I love the exterior. I'm not going to touch the exterior. So so that's what it is. This is the second floor. That's a kind of a couple of sexy-looking thesis students before they actually went and got their hands dirty, I think. This is the rest of downtown. The post office and G.B. Wood's general store. That's actually Sambo's truck outside the general store. It's a terrific place because you can go there with an 6x8 card, and you can kind of get a tab going. And Mockbee used to call it the Students' Union. This is Francis Sullivan. What are you laughing at?
I told you I was going to. This is home. This is home slides. This is like holiday slides. You're not going to see any architecture. Frances Sullivan. She's a delightful woman. She looks after our students, and is very much the centre of our community. And then here's GB on the right, and this is my neighbour Henry. You all notice his fantastic diet that he's got going there. And then right in the middle of Newbern, actually opposite that house I just showed you, is sort of the latest acquisition of the Royal Studio. It's not that recent, but we were given this building. And we were actually given the property, but we had to take the building. And the deal with the building was that it has a lien on it by the Alabama Historical Commission. And the reason for that is, you all know Gone with the Wind, Margaret Mitchell? But apparently, Margaret Mitchell may well have walked her dog in the front yard. it's literally that dubious. So, and the real kicker is that the building was somewhere else. It was in Greensboro, and they delivered it to us in three pieces and plonked it down here, so
it needs fastening together. And anyway,
so, you know, Alabama Historical Commission, basically, they need a total and utter historic restoration of this. So you can imagine my students would be really good at that. It probably will cost us at least $2 million and don't exactly have that change at the moment. So it's kind of just sitting there.
But it is in the centre of the community.
So what we did instead was we built ourselves an amphitheatre behind the back of it. And this is where we can kind of have our own performances. We can set up events as a kind of a neutral armature in the community. Essentially, the black folks live over here and the white folks live over that side. And it's in the center of the community. This is where we have our end of year kind of festivities. This is actually Dexter Thornton, who's a local black entertainment comedian. And he wants to run with this thing and make it his own. So I'm hoping he will one day. But there's kind of subtext to this story. And one of the reasons that you know, it's not exactly the reason the Royal Studio exists, is that the county is so poor that there is no money to police the building permit process. They don't have a guy in the council who, or in the local authorities, to do that. So I essentially, and the other faculty, are the policemen of the work that goes on out here. There is a certain building code, but there's no one to police it. So when we do the drawings, there's no one to show them to. So I essentially can go out tomorrow and build whatever the hell I want, which is both wonderful and frightening at the same time. And that's why we get grown-up engineers like these guys to tell us, yes, it ain't going to fall over because you'll be in a lot of mess. So there's a responsibility to that, and a moral responsibility. Certainly I can build buildings without handrails, but my students are the first ones to say, you know, we should go by code, and you know, what about this? And I think so. It becomes, what's nice about it is it's more of a social agreement than a list of design guidelines, which I think the building permits have become at the moment. I mean, it's made our cities homogeneous, and I think pretty damn dull because of them. So they don't provide a guide for the building permits, but when I wanted to dig this hole in the backyard here, the Alabama Historical Commission said, well, I'm sorry, you can't do that until we've sent some archaeologists down to understand what's in the backyard. And I said, well, but the building wasn't on this site before. and of course, they said it doesn't matter. So they sent three archaeologists down for 3 days, scratching around in the backyard looking for old Coke cans or something, and found... But so they spend money on that, 3 times 3 is 9 days, and you know, you have 9 days of a building inspector for that money. So they value that, but not other stuff, which is about basic human necessity. And so you can read.
I don't have to spell it out.
So this is what they all look like at the beginning of the semester, pretty dreadful, all clean and kind of raring to go. Basically between the ages of 19 and about 24, I suppose. We have about 26 students. I look after the outreach and the thesis. We have a second year supervisor. We have a guy who sort of helps us out with tools and some other stuff. But it's pretty bare bones infrastructure. We like it lean and mean, and then there's a couple of lovely ladies who help us with the administration. And you know, it has changed. I mean, the over the last 4 years, this guy got dropped dead, this guy got sick, this guy ran off with a woman from New York. So that left me basically with these two gorgeous women. So I did the obvious thing and I went out and hired two guys that were interested in cross-dressing. I'm glad you're getting the jokes, it's good. They didn't get it at the RIBA last night, but... So at my job as a teacher, I get to, you know, actually get to build stuff as well, and that's the kind of delight. I'm not just in the studio like the students. I get the opportunity occasionally to go on site. But that red barn is bloody cold in winter as well, and it's not... You all have nice air conditioning units and heaters here. We don't have that. This is my office, the big green truck. These are my two assistants who are life prisoners, actually. They're from the local cattle ranch, which is the state prison. And they do a fantastic job for us. We have this thing organized with the state prison where they send two-day release workers out. And they keep our property clean. And I mean, Auburn doesn't know about this, so don't go telling them. But it's a very important part of our infrastructure. Brett, you need it, okay? Talk to Tony, see if you can work it out. Margaret Thatcher would call it caring the community. This is the second year's. The second year's essentially do a charity house. They come in essentially as two groups of 15, and we sort of two consecutive semesters, and they build a house, and that's essentially a year's worth of work. We encourage, you know, any means of negotiation possible. They didn't like that guy, so. But the negotiation is and the design of these projects, when you have a group of 15, it's the hardest job in the world, quite honestly. 15 people who want to be the conductor of the orchestra. But we there's a variety of ways that we've done it, and you know, obviously, typically, you'll get the students can design their own individual house for their client, or they will kind of. And then at the end of that, we'll kind of mush these things together and say, well, it looks like there's four basic ideas. And then you take those four ideas and you present them to the client. And you try to present them in a manner that your poor client, who is typically overwhelmed by this, you know, we try to look at models. We do a lot of three-dimensional work. We'll show them a lot of different materials. And you do your very best to try to speak their language. And then at the end of the day, and what the Royal Studio, I guess, is best known for, they get to go out and, you know, do foundations and put the septic in and do the electric and the plumbing and put the roof on and do it all. And that kind of understanding of what you draw and what it converts to is hugely important. The thesis students, and they come out essentially as individuals and then choose their teams when they get out to a Royal Studio. They get to program the project, they get to raise money for the project, they get to work very closely with the client in terms of the programming and fundraising. Often, I mean, currently we're doing a dog pound in Hale County. The county has absolutely no idea of the legal situation. So our students have spent the last 6 months researching all of the legal implications for them before we even get into the program. So there's a sort of there's an amazing kind of array of stuff that the students get thrown at them. They work like you all do at school. You know, they work as a team. They present to their classmates. They go to the site and they bring the site back to the studio. I really try and encourage the students to be at site 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, in all weathers, in all climes, in all seasons. So you really get to. That's the luxury of our situation, and it's stupid not to take advantage of it. We do an awful lot of kind of three-dimensional work that we hope will kind of be tests for how we begin to present it to the client. Because clients can't read plans. Our clients can't. I mean, probably most of your clients can't either. So how do you get into a vocabulary that they can understand? We make a lot of models. You even go onto site and do mock-ups. So you're going to do a drawing that looks like it's 27 feet up in the air. What does that mean when you get out there? And we have that chance, again, to go there and test it. Do an awful lot of detailed drawings, and an awful lot of drawing generally. It has changed since I showed up. I really believe in the value of the drawing. But it's also it's easier to communicate with each other. And honestly, the reason there are not any drawings published with the finished projects is that the drawings they get lost in the battle at the end. You know, you use them to begin to start making, and you draw the details, and as you make the building, it's not the finished product. So a lot of mock-ups of details, even computer renderings. You know, this was actually a pretty simple fly-through I should explain what the hell this project is. This is the reason apparently we were an emerging vision, and being an emerging vision, one of our students entered this for the competition, unbeknownst to me, and we were one of the winners, apparently, so that's why I showed up in London yesterday, which was nice. But this project was for Perry County. Perry County is the poorest county in Alabama. The probate judge had been working for the last 10 years to get some money to reopen the park. They had no outdoor recreational facilities. He got the money and he asked us if we wanted to help work with them, and I said, fantastic. So the first piece was a pavilion. Let's get the politicians on the front of the newspaper standing underneath a nice pavilion and everyone will be happy. So that was the impetus for this. In that process, the students get to, you know, present their projects to their critics on site. Then the best bit, they get to present to their clients. And this we rehearse like you can't believe. This is these rehearsals for these things are very important, just because, as you all know, it doesn't matter how good the drawings are, if what comes out your mouth is ridiculous, you've lost it. So you have to rehearse very carefully. This particular client, tremendous kind of range of people from Perry County, two county commissioners, probate judge, the mayor, couple of school teachers, really just an amazing client in a county that was really kind of politically divided. The students we get to be very entrepreneurial, get themselves on the front of the newspaper, asking the local people to give them donations of cedar for the project, because we wanted to build a pavilion out of cedar, and there were lots of cedar trees on people's properties. Then you get to go off and start building it, which is the fun bit. We now have our own bobcat, or you work with local contractors, but you know, it's even, you know, just laying out a site confuses most people. This is one of the footings from the pavilion. All of the cedar that we got donated, we cut the trees down, we milled all of the wood, and we took all the bark and then put the bark inside the formwork that we made for the footings of the columns. And then when you take the formwork off, it leaves the residue on the column footings. And it created a very pretty detail, I think. And sort of the ground, if you like. If we're doing a really heavy lifting, we get local contractors to come and help us. Real structural welding, we expect somebody else to do it, unless we back it up with a bolted connection. So really, typically, anything that's structural, that the local guys do for us. And then, of course, you get to kind of stand back and drink beer while they build it for you. But then the difficult part comes as you begin to realize, how the hell am I going to get 27 feet up in the air and build this sucker? So, and of course, at the Royal Studio, we absolutely insist on no hard hats. It's kind of a point of... But they get to learn to do this stuff, and they learn by their own mistakes. I love this image. I don't know how many of you can see it, but the framing for this, the first bay they framed out, I came out and I said, what the hell are you doing up here at this front end? Because what they had done was they had fanned the roof rafters. So they thought that they were kind of just dividing the span with the roof rafters, but it became impossible. You know, you're standing on the roof on the plywood trying to find those rafters, because typically you space them at 16 inches on center. And they thought fanning them was really smart. So, and I showed them, and they changed it up here for the next one, but then they changed back. So what can you say?
Yeah. I guess I was too much of a wise ass.
But then there was this issue, and you know, when you're building a project like this, it's sort of 27 feet up in the air, there's four of you, there's a lot of shit to lift up on the roof here. It would be nice not to have to come in afterwards and do the underside. And that's, you know, holding stuff up in the air and all of that business. And we had a lot of discussions and negotiations about that. And in the end, they decided to sheathe it in plywood and then sheathe it in metal. And I think that they were right. But you know, that's, again, it falls to them to be the builder of that and the maker of that. They understand the implications of their decision. So they put the plywood up. They taught themselves to use the metal break. They had the opening, and everyone loved them. And you can see they were right. I mean, the borrowed light on the underside of this is just really beautiful. And even down to the kind of conversation about will it oil cam, where you put the screws through it. Actually, and I had kind of got onto them about that, but they liked it. They liked the fact that it pillowed a little bit. So it kind of, it made the light act in little, in dappled ways. So.
Essentially, the pavilion is two, obviously, it's two kind of dancing planes. The bottom one is made of cedar, which comes up and it forms an entranceway.
So you walk underneath the deck to get in at that side, and then there's, you know, these kind of folding seats.
And then there's always a little bit of sex in rural studio projects.
This is the sunset porch. The sunset's over here, so this is where you can cuddle with your honey.
These two were caught cuddling at some point. And this is my students suggesting that a rural studio is the number one architecture school in the world, not the AA.
But the women is the women are the rural studio is very macho in its early stages for whatever reason, I guess, kind of. You know, hammering and all of that stuff, it makes it sort of a macho thing. But in the last 6 years, I think that the projects have improved significantly because we've gone pretty much 50-50. And, you know, it's very nice to see the guys kind of coming out to rural studio pretending they know how to wield a hammer and do all of this stuff. And then when you get out on site, gloves come off and everyone suddenly realizes nobody knows anything at all. And so it's a wonderful kind of
leveling of the playing field.
This particular project, unfortunately, Hurricane Ivan came through, and Hurricane Ivan spawned some tornadoes. And this big old tree here
hit our little pavilion.
And the triumph is Tim McFarlane actually engineered those pin connections. One-inch pin connection, one-inch pin connection. They held. So, much to our amazement. So the 15-inch beam got smashed right in the center. And that's
you can see the amount of force came through.
It blew out the foundation. So obviously we were a little bit close to the edge, I figure here. But
and we have rebuilt it.
FEMA gave us $10,000 to rebuild it.
And we just decided, instead of trying to play at architects, we'd just rebuild it again. And
we've rebuilt that last bay. So. This is, so to that mix, which is the undergraduate program at Auburn, and to that community, we brought, a few years ago, we brought a group of students called the Outreach Studio, and they are students who are not from Auburn. They're essentially graduate students, and it's a way for us to kind of get some interesting folks into what is typically a very dull bunch of
just architects talking to each other.
And over the past few years,
you know, we had Cynthia Connolly who came, she was a photographer, came down and she did this organic farm stand.
Richard Saxton did, he discovered that York in Alabama, they had no kind of service pods for the road sweepers. And so he went on eBay and he bought these three tricycles and kind of retrofitted them to turn them into kind of road sweeping service. And then Lucy Begg took on this project, which was essentially this little porch, and it was a challenge to the way that people live in trailers at the moment. They sort of live this very precarious existence of it's either summer or it's winter, either the air conditioning's running or the heating's running. There are two seasons. And we were trying to encourage this woman to begin to live. You can live 70% of your life outdoors. It's temperate enough to be able to do that. So that was the challenge to that that client in a sense. And then most recently what we're doing is we're doing a project called the $20,000 house, which it's a HUD rural development grant for $20,000 that the poorest of the poor can get. The kicker behind it is, though, that, you know, HUD offers this rural development loan, but there's no model for it. There's no approved model. The smallest approved model is for $80,000. So the government says it provides this, but then it makes it impossible to achieve. So what we did was we looked at it, and the first year we split that $20,000 in half, said here's $10,000 for a builder for profit and labor. Let's see what we can do for 10 grand, which is essentially £6,000. And this is about £6,000 worth of materials. And, you know, actually Hannah's to blame for this. It's 720, is it? 720 square feet?
600.
600. Oh, it's less. But it's...
So
the porch slides along the front, and the idea was that if the thing changed orientations, you could move the porch along. And it's down and dirty, but she loves it. This year's group, we've actually got a group of purely architecture students in to look at the same problem. So it's a problem we're going to keep looking at for a few years, I hope. I'll try and go faster. The history of the rural studio is essentially sort of based on looking at the rural house, and the first house that they ever did was the straw bale house. This is for the wonderful lady that you saw at the beginning. It's the kind of classic southern porch, a little smokehouse, and this was intended as the room that they would inhabit most of the year, and indeed they did. Then out the back are three little wagon wheels for their nephews and nieces to live in. So it was this idea of the kind of the family constantly changing. And Shep and Alberta, you can see the inside of these houses. Often people are very shocked by when they come down to the rural studio having seen the sexy magazine photographs, and then they go inside and it's like, well, you know, these people just live here. They're very unpretentious. It's home. It's not, but they still love their home, but it's not the kind of work of art that everyone expects them to treat it as. And here's the front porch. This is the kind of detritus of everyday life, you know. Shepherd was a fisherman. There were always turtles in these buckets here. You know, fish heads in the refrigerator. I mean, there was stuff there. And then this is the smokehouse that was reputedly built for $40, although actually every rural studio project costs $40. Mockbee used to call it the Alabama Ronchon. You know, you see the pretty little bottles. And the stone road signs. But the key to this was, you know, Mockbee's relationship with the client. And if you have 30 students, you don't want the students saying yes to the client all the time, because you can't imagine what the program would end up for the house. So I think Mockbee's hand is very clear in this project. And it was the first project, and he was kind of smart about that, that you're going to set up a program like this. You want to get something out there that people are going to talk about. Second house, and the second best house we've ever done, I would suggest, and we're still trying to live up to it, it's the Butterfly House. The great porch again, Anderson and Oralee Harris. Unfortunately, they've both died now, but it's a kind of classic two-semester project. You build the dump piece in the first semester, and then the second group comes along and says, this is really boring, what are we going to do with it? And they put this kind of sexy roof on the front of it. That's looking at its worst in winter, but Anderson was a terrific gardener and always made it look beautiful. Just as a kind of an example of how unpretentious they live. I mean, this is the Tim Hursley staged photograph, and then that's the reality of it. Anderson, you know.
It's much better, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, but a little perverse, actually. They used to cut things out of magazines, and there's a wonderful situation in here where he's got, or he did have, because he had, there was an image of George Bush next to Martin Luther King, and I could never really kind of figure that relationship out. So then one of the latest projects we've done for the second year is a house for a very shy and retiring young fellow called Music Man. He lives at 334 Bates Mill Road. He's and he's in the phone book as Mr. Eyes Cancer. He is somewhat of an eccentric, but very much loved throughout the Cole community. He collects everything. He's the only person in West Alabama to have a motor scooter. And a true story, pretty recently actually, is that you'll notice there's no license plate on this. And he kept getting tickets because he didn't have a license plate. There was a new young constable in town, and he kept giving Music Man tickets. And finally, the local county court judge, Judge Ryan, went up to the police officer and said, "Look, you've got to stop giving Music Man tickets. He's above the law." So, so he is a collector. All of these buildings around are essentially where his family lives. So there's this kind of strange settlement there that when we went in there, we were going to kind of bulldoze them, and he was very upset. So you cannot touch. This is his family history. So you just have to kind of keep adding.
So this, obviously, the reason he's called Music Man, or one of the reasons he's called Music Man, you go there and, you know, there's like 300 decibels of sound coming out of this room, and you can't find the off switch.
You know, so,
but he makes signs that kind of delineate his presence and his territory. He was unbelievable with the students. He was, you know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week on site. This is,
you know, our students do not meet people like this, and this guy does not meet people like our students. So that was a kind of a lovely opportunity to bring folks together. The house is pretty damn simple, little wood frame house. And sort of pedagogically, the challenge to them was, you know, build this out of wood, classic stick frame construction, and then the bathroom can be, you know, I said, well, why don't you, and they said something like, we want to do something organic. And I said, well, why don't you try and make an organic form out of 2x4s?
And so they tried it, and I guess they learned to build a wiggly wall. But it slides between the trees that Music Man actually planted. And this is it.
This is how it ended up. It's, for my taste personally, it's far too mannerist. And, you know, what is sort of one man's trash, why should that be another man's, you know, art? But I think it's a kind of classic second year house, very mannerist.
Every detail, everything is detailed to the nth degree. It's like, I want to show my mum I did this, and I want to show my mum I did this.
So it's okay from that point of view, and I think given Music Man's personality, it fits well. And you'll see later. Down to the point where there are actually skateboard wheels on the top of this structure that allow all the pieces of furniture to move around the space. So when he gets in bed, if he's too cold, he can actually wheel the bed towards the heater.
I think this is the bathroom. I think it's fair to say that he's probably the happiest man in West Alabama. He gets lots of visitors.
This is his early warning system. The dogs.
And he has this amazing entrance gate.
You know, this he calls the Batmobile entrance. Yeah. All right. So he can open the central entrance for his motor scooter, and then the whole thing can open for when you bring a truck in there. And, you know, again, a little disturbed, because I'm, you know, one of those, I'm an AA educated architect, so I don't know about stuff like this, but Well, what has happened, and what, you know, you noticed the signs before, and he genuinely marked his territory with signs, and what's fantastic now is he started to put signs in this, so he's taken this over, and, you know, he worked with the guy that built this as well, so,
you know, would I have done it? No, but I'm probably not clever enough to do that. So,
the other aspect of the studio is these thesis projects that sort of started out as pretty small-scale things like the smokehouse and have become something different. Students come out in teams of three and four and are given this opportunity to kind of almost have a once-in-a-lifetime experience. This is one of the first ones, which is just an amazing piece of architecture. It's called the Yancey Tire Chapel. It's built out of
900 tires covered in pink concrete. The guy that had all these tires in Selma was going to be put in prison because of this. You know, he had these 900 tires laying around in his front yard, and so
we took them off his hand and sort of turned it into this.
And the spectacular thing about this project is its sighting.
It sits on the edge of a crevice, and it's very difficult to photograph it, but you walk in through this entrance, and the church just lays itself out in front of you with a spectacular view behind it.
It's really an extraordinary place. The sad, and
you know, again, Mockbee at the beginning found a good client. This was a private client. This was on private property. And the problem with this project now is that that's come back to bite us, because the woman died, the person that inherited it doesn't like the rural studio, doesn't want people on her property, so I can't show this to anybody. And it's a big shame because,
this is an extraordinary space. It's just really extraordinary. And the roof and all of this.
This was all taken from a barn and recycled from an old house. I mean, it's really a beautiful thing.
These are the guys that built it. They used to kind of...
They put dirt into the tires and then put rebar in, and rumour was that they used to beat it in there naked. So the locals all used to kind of show up to try and see them beating this dirt in naked. That's a rural studio story for you. Down in Mason's Bend, this is a project some of you will be familiar with. This is what Mockbee called a pocket of poverty. Little fishing community, and the students were offered an opportunity to build a little thing called the Glass Chapel. It's a kind of a community centre come chapel. It's built of rammed earth walls with this pretty magical stainless steel folding roof, and then over the top of it are these Chevrolet Caprice windscreen
shields. And I think,
I think, you know, at various points, schools of architecture go through very kind of fashionable phases, and I think everyone wanted to do a fish skin at that point. And so these guys actually figured it out. They went to a wrecker's yard in Chicago. It was one of those deals where you can take away everything you can carry for $50. And so they took a whole bunch of windshields back to Hale County, and they figured out that the Chevrolet Caprices had these holes drilled in them for the winding mechanism, which is kind of brilliant. And so they attached it to a framework, and this is the mock-up they built. And then this is Forrest Fulton installing it. So, and it sits atop a rammed earth wall. We've experimented with rammed earth in a number of situations, but we still have some freeze-thaw cycles. So it's not great, really, for where we are, unless you completely build a roof over this thing. It's a little bit fragile. The other stupid thing about rammed earth is you've got to kind of build a wall before you build a wall. And
yeah, that. Anyway, it's a very pretty space. Difficulty with this project was poor programming. The owner died, and you know we work very hard these days on making sure on the sustainability of the programming, that there's going to be someone around to look after this thing, because essentially it's fallen to us to look after it, and the kind of the patriarch of the community died, and the inheritors haven't taken it on, so it's sort of become our responsibility. And I think that, you know, on Mockbee's passing, what happened to the Royal Studio was really nothing much changed, but I think that we have started to have to fix old projects. And so the emphasis now is on, you know, better detailing,
we still want to have the same spirit, but we want better detailing, we want kind of smart decisions, economic decisions, but let's make these projects last a long time. Let's really focus very hard on the programming and the sustainability of the programming, and not just leave it all to chance. Saying that, one of the last projects before he died was a little cardboard house, in which the one of the victims of this project is sitting in the audience tonight. These are wax impregnated cardboard bales. They weigh between 750 pounds and 1200 pounds each. They are, when you stamp a cardboard box, you stamp the template for a cardboard box, the outside of it is shredded and put into a bale. So it's clean. But because it's got wax in it, they can't get the wax out of the cardboard and vice versa, so there's nothing they can do about it. So they literally put tons of this stuff in the landfill every day. It's kind of ridiculous. There's no use for it. And one of the students' fathers was involved in the industry, so we got all this stuff. And of course, the first thing we did was like, well, what happens if you torch it? And nothing much, actually, because it's so tightly bound that it doesn't. There's no oxygen in there, so it'll smolder. In fact, it smoldered for 3 days in Newbern and absolutely pissed everybody off. But it, structurally, it wasn't, you know, the structural section was still okay. So we did a foundation out of it. We built ourselves a ring beam on top of it to deal with the differential settlement and to give us a flat surface to build on. And then this is Gabe. Gabe actually did some work when a photographer showed up. And the problem is you need a bobcat to move the stuff around. There was some nonsense talked at the time about emergency housing. Well, hey, you'd need some damn big jumbo jets to move this stuff if you're going to use it for that. And then, you know, I guess this was Amy's decision, but here's this lovely idea of, you know, this cardboard bales that's like an R value of like 3 million. And then you decide you're going to put yourself a sexy little, very paper-thin roof on the top of it and just let that heat fly out of the roof instead. So I wanted them to do this, but they were chicken. So, but it's a nice piece, and it's we even practiced some renders. We did a dirt and cement and water render, and that's actually really lasted, but we wanted people to see it was made of cardboard. We put a big roof over it. You know, again, lessons of Hale County. Protect the wall, make sure that the water doesn't get at the base of the foundation of the wall. It's one of those things that people enjoy. That, you know, it's got a cardboard door, cardboard floor. So more recently, our recycling has sort of taken other forms. We've had the opportunity to kind of recycle buildings. This was a new headquarters building for Hero. Suddenly we become, Oprah Winfrey had us on TV, and when Oprah thinks you're good, it's like, okay, well, maybe they're cool if Oprah thinks you're good. So in Greensboro, they Hero asked us to do a new headquarters on Main Street. And Main Street, you can see what the idea behind Main Street is. This is the contemporary street furniture of Main Street. So this was a little bit controversial that they let us loose on Main Street, and this is what we did. This essentially, we kind of stripped it out like a loft. There was very little money, and the facades are all based. These facades are all based on donated tempered glass. That's when they temper glass in production. If it gets to the site and it's too small, there's nothing they can do with it. And literally, honest to God, this elevation is based on some glass that was donated to us. And then the back facade, by the time, what we found out was that the old wooden storefront was actually holding that front wall up. So we spent most of the project money on the front facade. And they kind of came to me one day in tears and said, what are we going to do about the back? And I said, well, go and talk to Pella. And we have a relationship with Pella that allows us into their seconds and rejects showroom. So we just did a kind of a Mondrian thing on the back wall with the Pella stuff. In Akron, we gave them a new seniors center. We turned this little building into this. Essentially extruded a glass box outside wanted to allow the senior citizens to be kind of on display, as was the idea, kind of have a relationship to the street. And on the left-hand side, gave them a big old community space. It's a big aircraft hangar door, and the party, the kind of street party, can come out onto the street. Another form of recycling, this little building, this is Antioch Baptist Church, 100-year-old Black Baptist Church with a congregation of about 15. They wanted us to look at the project, and the problem with the building was it was being severely undermined by water coming down the hill and essentially pushing the foundations away. So the thing had started to do this. And I said to them, look, I think this is just not, it's not worth our time and energy to jack this thing up and do the foundations. It's just going to happen again, probably. So we proposed moving up the hill, and the challenge to the students was, could we recycle the entire building? And I think, if our calculations are right, it's about 80% recycled, all of the materials from this, from the roof to the timber frame structure, and also the one-by siding. So by Christmas, they'd torn it down, documented all the materials, and they built them a new chapel. Because if you imagine 14 people, they lose their chapel, where they've been going, their families have been going for 100 years, they're going to go somewhere else. So it was important for us to do that. It's the foundations coming out, moved up the hill. A lot of help, that's actually the county, two county engineer and a catfish farmer came to help us put these trusses in place. And this is it at graduation day. And it's, you know, the recent commitment of the students has just been absolutely phenomenal. They take on these big public projects. They graduate on May the 5th. And some of them have stayed as much as a year beyond that to finish out these things. And it's terrific to be in a situation where people just do it because they want to do it. This, and you know, the whole family gets involved. This is Jared and his brother Forrest and little brother who wants to come to the rural studio. And this is Mum. She's not very pleased about the idea of little brother coming to studio, but you know, Mum actually planed all of the one-by material from the original building. She put it through a metal detector and then planed it all. So you can see the whole family gets into this. This is how it finished up. It's kind of a double wrap, a north-south and an east-west. The east-west contains the preacher's room and a little restroom, and then the west side contains the pulpit and all of that other stuff. And then north-south, the south face is a big solid wall, and then the north face kind of opens up to the graveyard. So there you see the graveyard. We had that big long window, all of that glass donated, so they knew right from the very beginning they had this glass and how we're going to use it in the project. That's how it's sited. And then inside, so all of the trusses are exposed. You can see the cemetery, and again, the congregation, all of their families are buried in that cemetery, so you know with that big window exactly where you're going to end up. And then, actually, this is more Tim McFarlane Engineering. I don't know if you remember this, but these little delicate things that transfer the loads, the wind load, up into these big trusses. I think you were on the boat, on the plane to LaGuardia or something when you talked to us about that. You were running, in case they call me again. And then they wanted a baptismal font, so we made the pulpit into this big old jacuzzi thing. That lifts up, and you can walk down into this thing, and it's a full submersion baptismal font, and it's covered in black tile, and it's got orange stripes on it that go off to infinity, and that's the full submersion for the Baptists. And the nice thing is that they can rent it out to other churches that haven't got one, so they can make a few dollars out of it. In Newbern, we did a couple of baseball fields. I'm sure some of you have seen this one. This was the first one. This was 100-year-old Negro League baseball field. Terrific part of West Alabama culture is baseball on Sunday afternoons. The students found this place in this condition, well-loved, well-organized, but not well-maintained. So they got in with the team and started to talk about giving them a new backstop. The backstop had originally been built in a weekend, and we kind of proposed this idea of chain link, and chain link not used like this, where you stretch it, it was actually hung. And it was not a way that had really been used before. And it allowed us to make these kind of sculptural forms. So that it was a delightful place to find when there was no game being played. And but it truly comes to life on game day. This is Newbern Tigers. And this is the home dugout. And then this is Susie Lee Williams cooking catfish. So they pull their, the vendors pull up, and they charge the vendors $30 on the gate, and people can sell beer, sell catfish, and they've got the music rocking, and it's, you know, everyone goes to church in the morning and they go out here in the afternoon and get a little bit naughty. And then one of the reasons to show this slide actually is this advantage of being on site. You know, you can imagine thesis students come out here and we want to build Wembley Stadium. It's going to be the Millennium Dome or something. And we ended up doing the backstop, and we were going to do some seating, but what we figured out was at 4 o'clock on game day, all of these seats are perfectly in shade. The only place that's not in shade is the away dugout. So we left the away dugout exactly where it was.
It's home field advantage. This was Jay Sanders, who was who was a student in that team. He actually became first base for them, and they call him Whitey, of course. But Jay became a second year teacher as well, and really terrific, just personality. And he was actually the one that instigated Music Man's House. Next door to that, we built a little league baseball field, because we decided we had to give something for the little kids as well, because the grown-ups wouldn't let the little kids play on their new field. So we gave them Slippery Elm Park, and
this was a bad piece of...
It was the only piece of property that anybody would offer us in that area for various reasons. And we ended up having... We got $25,000 from Baseball Tomorrow to finance it, and it just wasn't enough. But we ended up having to do a whole bunch of earth moving. And this is what they used to move catfish ponds. You can actually stand up inside that. It's a big piece of equipment. They're satellite controlled. I mean, they're magnificent things. And this is what it ended up like. Our students kind of finessed at certain points with some concrete seating, and then we put this big old slinky around the field so that you kind of encapsulate the audience, because it's such a young audience. And then we covered it with catfish net, so that, you know, that seining net that you saw earlier. We've discovered that catfish net virtually had exactly the same properties as the net they use in Major League Baseball. You know, you can imagine it's in water all day, it has to deal with ultraviolets, all that stuff. And the real kicker is that the guy that runs the team's a catfish guy, and so he knows how to fix it. So all of these things are not actually bugs. They're where the net has been fixed, and they fix it they know how to fix it, and so I guess that's what you might call sustainability or something. One of those silly S words. This was opening day. It was amazing. They had a young woman from a local high school singing the Star Spangled Banner, and everyone was standing to attention. It's just unbelievable. Then down in Talliston, a little project we did. This is actually Paul sitting over there. He's probably still in recovery. How is the clinic, Paul?
The high schools in Alabama suffered when desegregation happened. The idea of desegregation was that blacks and whites would live together happily, and when desegregation happened, they decided they didn't want to live together happily. So they abandoned the high schools that they were supposed to be in. So in this situation, and I should have the photograph, but over here is a magnificent red brick high school, and next to it is a magnificent gymnasium. And then there was this little crappy building which was for home economics and also for kind of woodworking for the guys. And Rural Heritage, who are this group, they're essentially a kind of a blue rinse group of little old ladies. That are really incredibly kind of dynamic and go-getting and trying to do something for their area. they turn out to be incredible grant writers, these people, and so they've established this little rural heritage centre that delights in our rural heritage. They look at different foods, they look at different arts, and so we helped them rebuild this building. And it was, they had a $190,000 grant from HUD. They were going to use a drywall contractor, and our students kind of surreptitiously sneaked a little plan under the door one day and said, how about help us helping you? And their committee turned around and said, yes, okay, we'll do it. And $190,000 sound like a lot of money to us, so we were eager to help. This is Paul on a backhoe. This, again, it's an ugly little building. I don't have the greatest of images for it, but the decision was made to put a big old sign on the front of the building to try and compete with the size of the mass of the other buildings, to kind of make a big celebration space. This is what we ended up with. These are structures from, they were essentially given to us. They're the structures that hold up the signs that go across expressways. So these are significant pieces. And we had these things donated, and so we put a big old sign on the front of the building and then sort of wrapped the rest of the building in cedar to kind of camouflage it a little bit. This is Rural Fun Day, one of the openings, one of the big occasions for openings at Rural Heritage Centre. This is actually a pepper jelly eating contest. That's apparently what rural fun is. And then this is our Elvis impersonator. Well, you always need an Elvis impersonator at Rural Fun Day. And then inside, strangely enough, this is not in order, but the first project we gave them was actually a gift shop. Strangely enough, in their original grant, they hadn't asked for a gift shop. And we said, well, where are you going to sell everything? And so we came back with this idea of converting the big kind of workshop into a sort of two galleries, one for significant sized pieces and one would be a jewelry box. So this is the jewelry box, and it kind of slides through a smaller building and looks as if it's sort of floating and has been pulled across. And it's sort of a little bit of Mies van der Rohe comes to West Alabama. So you don't, you know, you, because all of the stuff they're going to put in it is so colorful, it's just crazy. So the last thing you want to do is compete with all of that nonsense. And then you enter through a jelly wall. They sell pepper jelly, that's their staple goodie. And we designed this jelly wall that when the sun sets in the evening, the sun comes through the jars of jelly and kind of lights them up pretty delightfully. There you see it. That's it with all the shit in it. There are some bigger sculptures out here now. It's rocking. I mean, they're just, there's a whole bunch of Blue Ridge ladies who are just lovers at the moment. Back to the park. I am getting close to the end, honest. This is a terrible drawing, but you can have got to imagine a lot of trees here, okay? These are Oxbow Lakes. The pavilions up there, the piece that you saw earlier. They were going to do a restroom that was going to be a prefabricated unit. And we asked after we did the pavilion if we could do the restrooms, and they said, yeah, great. And so we took the $50,000 and we gave them three restrooms, either a team that do it, two guys and two girls. And what we ended up with was three restrooms that I think are probably the most ridiculous pooping experiences in the United States of America. This is the walkway that goes to the pavilion through the woods, so it keeps you off the ground if you want to enter the pavilion. But this is the tower restroom, so you sit at the bottom of the tower. This is the mound pavilion that sits in the middle of the septic field, septic mound, and this is the what we call the long toilet, which has arms that come out and grabs the landscape. So this is what you see inside the tower when you're sitting on the toilet. You get that view. And then the long toilet has these two arms, again, that come out and grab these trees, so you can kind of sit on the john and inspect the tree. And then the mound toilet, and the parking is just here. So there's this kind of little naughty thing peeking up over this grass. It's a little kind of... And then kind of slopes down and gives you this horizontal slot. And you can imagine kind of sitting there with your shotgun and just, you know, taking pot shots as rabbits run across or something. But again, a very similar kind of materials language as the first pavilion project. Took the cedar, In this case, we had the opportunity to use stainless steel siding because I went to the grant people and said, look, I don't need $50,000 to do these three toilets. Can we use it somewhere in the park? And they said, no. If you don't use it, you'll lose it. And so I said to the student, well, go on, you know, what's the material that's going to last the longest? And Melissa Sullivan went up to Birmingham and found a retired sheet metal guy who came down and helped.
Melissa, she folded and bent every piece of the stainless steel that you see. It's a very beautiful job. And then round the corner from that, given
that momentum, one of the local ornithologists was trying to get us to open up the east side of the park. He'd got a grant to make trails, show people what a fantastic landscape was. And the east side of the park's the most beautiful but inaccessible side of the park. So we decided to build a bridge. In fact, the first team wanted to build a bridge and a tower, which was a little bit optimistic, I would say. So this was the bridge that we did. It has a kind of a Toblerone section with a hanging walkway underneath it.
And this is just one of the early sort of photo montages they showed to the client of this roof sliding through.
And then this is where Anderson gets famous. We pretty much built his diagram. Here's the point of load, here's the tie back, the restraint point, and then here's the cantilever. So it was built in three sections, two outer sections pulled down, balance point here and cantilever point here, and then the central section was just dropped in.
Perspective underneath the walk through, you know, the kinds of drawings that we talk, kind of discuss things through by facts with engineers. And the students have also become pretty damn good at doing, when we get stuff fabricated by other people, they do pretty decent shop drawings. But this one we kind of fabricated ourselves because we had a lot of tubular steel donated. Tubular steel and metal angle. And so we kind of cobbled the whole thing together, built it in a parking lot up the road, and then had to figure out how to get it to the bridge site. And
we figured out that what we would do is put a trailer axle on it. And then we put a hookup at one end and literally just ran it down the road on the back of a pickup. That's actually me here holding up this corner, which was dragging on the corner. And yeah, it was fantastic for the students to understand the whole staging process, and that truss was never going to be under as much stress as it was when it was on the back of a pickup.
Yeah. And then the great thing, the kids got a
crane works from Birmingham to donate this very large crane that had its own 18-wheeler as a counterbalance
and lifted it up into place. This was on a Saturday morning. This is giving you goosebumps, these moments. So then the two trusses went into place on either end. Really beautiful. Now this is the great one.
This is Sarah Singleton with a tape measure measuring between the two trusses, which seemed to be a little bit too late by then.
Yeah. And then the final one was dropped in and it all worked. And we covered it. It's a covered bridge. You know, all the
structure was exposed, all made of untreated cypress, and the metal was all left untreated.
So and it's protected by a roof, so that's the roof. And you can see the cable ties
going down here into the cement, into the concrete. And then this is a tie that runs through this concrete and goes out to the center of the bridge to stabilize it this way.
And a little eyebrow that comes up so that tall people like me can actually see out. That's the walkway hanging from underneath it. It sways a little, but it should, you know. And then you arrive at the other side and you're on what they call Ridge Trail. And Ridge Trail takes you to this desire of the local ornithologist, which was
build us a tower, build us a birding tower. And we want to be above the trees. So we spent 6 weeks scratching our heads about how we could build it out of wood. And someone showed up at the rural studio and said, why don't you just go off and get one of those fire towers that they're not using anymore, that the foresters use? And I said, that's a good idea. Why didn't we think of that earlier? So that's what we did. We went into Mississippi, found this tower. They gave it to us for a dollar. And I proceeded to realize that I had just let us into building a 100-foot tower and thought, what would a grown-up do about this? And so I said, screw it, we'll get them trained. So this is them. They trained on it, and we had tower erectors come from Texas who are experts they work on oil rigs and on airport buildings. And they got 2 days of training, and they even went through safety training. I mean, they went through the whole thing. This was, they are, you know, they can put it on their CV now. Not only did they go to the Royal Studio, but they can take towers down. And they feel very macho about it, of course. But it, you know, that's the view at 100 feet up. You're above the canopy. And we sold it to the county, who were very nervous about it. As you can imagine, if someone falls off a tower like this and sues the county will literally be owned by somebody. So this was no little act of imagination on behalf of the county. And the project is still being built because the state at one point put their hand up and said, stop, you can't do this, and got the county to jump through a whole bunch of hoops. So I'm really proud of the county for sticking in, and the students who just hung in with this project and said, look, if we get this to this site, well, it's going to be the only one in the United States of America that's 100 feet high, that's above the canopy, and birders are going to come from all over the place to come and use this thing. They will spend their dollars in Perry County, which is the poorest county in Alabama, and so kind of everyone wins. So, and you know, given its situation, we decided to put it into the ground with helical anchors, which they're essentially a corkscrew. You put them into ground, they can go down like 30, 40 feet till you even hit bedrock. They're a remarkable device. They've just started using them in America for domestic construction, and we decided, of course, no one had ever put these on as a foundation for a tower, but we kind of liked the idea of no concrete because it was also inaccessible anyway. So there's the tower. Each corner of the tower had four helical anchors, and that's the process. You can see the bobcat just has a spinning device on the top of them, and they're essentially screwed down, and then there's an extension put on and screwed down further and another extension. And that's the big old plate that they sit on that kind of transfers the load from the column into the from the foundation into the column. And they did the walkway using it as well. We wanted to kind of do, we put the tower right next to this amazing lake that has these beautiful cypress and tupelo swamp. And we danced it along the edge of the ecotone. So as you walked along, you were kind of precariously over the edge. Unfortunately, the county got really nervous. So, I mean, saying that they got really nervous, they asked us to put a handrail on both sides. So now there are two kind of silver ribbons. It's not so bad, but it's a shame because it was a nice asymmetrical thing. You walk this side and you dangled your legs over the other side if you wanted to sit over the water. But it wasn't worth killing the project for. So those are so the idea is you take you on these walks, give you these views, and you don't even know you're going to bump into this thing, you know. So you're walking along, that's one of the cantilevers. That's the helical anchor. So you can see how slender it all becomes. And the zigzag actually made it incredibly rigid. And then there's the tower. And they're up at 100 feet. They had their topping out ceremony last week. And they're in the process of taking the ribbon up. So this ribbon kind of continues all the way up the top of the tower. The nice, lovely thing is they've been selling steps and platforms. So they actually raised $17,000. They're going to put a little plaque with your name, the favorite bird on it. So they pretty much paid for the project through sponsorship of the steps and the platforms. That's the view down of the zigzag. That's the view from the lake. You can see it disappears in the trees. Really spectacularly engineered. You know, we re-galvanized the whole structure. So it's sort of been a refurb. And now what we're doing is putting the handrail in the infill. And that's the architecture of it. Almost done. This is Newbern. We're very proud of this. This is a new fire station and town hall for Newbern. Newbern hadn't had no new buildings for 110 years. And the town came to us and asked us if we build a fire station and a town hall. And it's like, okay, we will try. And this is a model.
These are that two of this is the rural studio hello sign, I guess. It's a very warm place to work.
This young lady actually lay a price. She raised $100,000 in materials donations for this project, just sitting on the telephone. But they, at graduation day on May the 5th, the only thing they had was half a slab. So you can imagine, mums and dads were not well pleased. And nor was the community, to be honest. They then spent the following summer building these trusses. And they're a pretty complicated truss because the building's 35 feet high, has no second floor or first floor, whatever the hell it is here. There's no intermediate platform. And so essentially these trusses have to take all the wind load. And they're a bypass system. You can see four layers of wood here with a metal kind of going in between. So they set up this amazing big jig to build these things. And it's a pretty macho project, but they showed up at the beginning of August, the next term, and put these things up in one day, and then suddenly everyone went, well, hellfire. We're going to have ourselves a fire station here. And this was kind of ridiculous, this project. But the best move we did was convincing the town to put it right up to the street. We showed them photographs from 1890 of the original buildings to this site, and they were all uptight to the street. And they understood the pattern from here, and we convinced them to move it right up to the edge. And it works
pretty nicely. But this is two guys and two girls built this. It took essentially 2 years. And it's a lot of systems, you know, it's just a lot. You know, there's a lot of trusses, there's a lot of exterior cladding, a lot of interior cladding. Even
on the south wall, we used polygal, but got big extruded strips of polygal that go the entire length. Then there's a little angle that allows you to connect the cedar slats to, which allow for shading from the southern sun. So in winter, I'll show you.
This is actually the opening day. All of Newbern came out for the opening day.
Terrific thing was that we had choreographed this thing for 6 o'clock at night. And what we did was all the lights were off, and then suddenly they turned on the alarm, the sirens and the lights. And the idea was they'd pull out. And of course, we could only get the fucking door up that far. And you could see Leia Price's feet, and she's like dancing around going, and unfortunately the door had unshipped from its mechanism. It's like you couldn't believe, you know, if there's one building where you can't have a door screw up.
So anyway, we finally got them out, and everyone cheered. But the town's terribly pleased with our fire station. You can see on the south side, here's the south wall with the cedar slats, the polygal.
So when the sun's high, stops the heat coming in. When the sun's low, heats up the slab, keeps the truck warm. Because that was the real basis. They needed a warm, dry place for their trucks, or they couldn't get the trucks. See, they'd started the fire department 2 years before, and the prerequisite was a warm, dry space for these trucks. And they were just named Alabama Volunteer Fire Department of the Year. So
they're all very proud of it.
Here's the south wall. There's a counterbalanced, you can't see it, but this is all on a counterbalance. There's two arms that go up inside with big counterweights on, so you can actually lift this thing up with two people.
And that's where the party can kind of spill out onto the parking lot.
You pull the trucks out at the front, and then you have a community party and town hall inside.
So it's kind of two buildings for one. That's the fire truck, the big gleaming new fire truck. I'm actually a member of Newbern Volunteer Fire Department. They're goddamn desperate if they ask me, I can tell you.
But here's the counterbalances here. So, and they extend out to the door, and so you just literally
let the door fall down. Finally, sort of an ode to Mockbee,
just to finish the cardboard, carpet, interface carpets asked us if we would do an exhibition with them. And they we kind of didn't know who Interface were, and it turns out they're the largest manufacturer of carpet tiles in the world, and they're trying their best to make these carpet tiles so that the cycle is completely closed, so that they don't take any minerals out of the ground anymore. But essentially what they dream of doing is we'll rent the tile off you. So when you've rented it and it's worn out, you then give it back and they put it back into their system, so that it's a closed cycle. They're known in the industry to kind of use the S word a lot, the sustainable word a lot. And we figured, well, there's worse bedfellows to jump in with. So we jumped in bed with them and said, well, what waste supplies do you have? And they sent us this stuff, and we said, well, that's
ugly.
And then they sent us this, and we said, well, that's kind of pretty. What's that? And so I spent my summer with Big Selma, who was an inmate at the time, with my head in a trash compactor, making these little hay bale-sized kind of furry dogs. They have plywood on the top and plywood on the bottom. And they're about 18 inches wide, about 18 inches high, and about 3 foot long. And then you put them in a wall, and they look really pretty. It's not quite as easy as that, but they, you know, the studs, there's a stud wall in here. It's a very simple 2x6 stud wall that's trapped in between each bale. And then you have a series of strips that fasten into the top of each of the bales. And then if you've got a load of free labor students, you then get them to go back in and kind of plug in the gaps and manicure it and give it a pedicure. And over here we made an opportunity for people to touch it, because people are like, you know, it's an exhibition, we can't touch that. And we put these tubes in here, and you could go up to the tubes and put your hand against the wall and watch the kind of dirty videos from the Royal Studio.
So then the challenge was, could we build a house out of carpet?
And this was just before Mockbee died, and we were still unfunded by the university, so we literally would jump in bed with anybody. And Sambo did a sketch of this house for Lucy, who is who's the child of the Bryants, and basically presented to Interface and said, look, can you help us with money for this? And they said yes, so we got 25,000 from Interface, plus all the carpet tile we wanted. And this was his sketch, a sort of undetermined material here, the sort of family room, the tower, tornado shelter, and then the porch. Big believer in the sun porch. I went over to Interface with the students, and this was just after Christmas, after he died, and asked the technical guy what he felt about what was the best way to put a carpet tile so it wouldn't combust. And he basically said, you know, just lay it the way it is, put it horizontally, and you should be fine. And I said, well, what about stacking it? He said, great, no problem. And so that's what we did, and we went back to Newbern and started testing it, and, you know, hosed it down. And the water only actually penetrated about a quarter of an inch, and if it was well ventilated, it would dry out. So we figured we were going to build a carpet tile wall. And we built ourselves a ring beam, and this was the structure. We weren't convinced of it all holding up a roof, however. So we kind of hid the structure inside the carpet tiles. And we proceeded to hand lay 72,000 carpet tiles. The difficult ones being the cuts around the column, which you had to do on a table saw. And the windows float inside the wall. And then you finish it. You can see, you actually build it against a formwork, so you've got something solid to build against, and you get a nice smooth edge. And then at the top, you put a ring beam on top of it. And then you walk around to each of the lolly columns and tighten them down. And you do it very evenly, so it kind of post-tensions it very evenly. And then the roof attaches to that. We also, I mean, this was sort of perverse, you know, kind of a joke on the students by Sambo, I think. This idea of a tornado shelter in this type of dirt, because the dirt's very expansive clay. But we gave her a tornado shelter, and obviously a big old slab. And we don't typically do slabs because, again, they get worked on by the clay very much, but that's how it ended up. You can see after Mockbee died, the kind of the students sort of split into two teams, and there was a competition to see who could be wackier than the other, I think. So here's the calm side, and then here's the wacky tower. And unfortunately, what got lost in the mix was the outdoor porch, the screened-in porch. But it's quite the wall is very beautiful. You know, the carpet wall. Lucy, unfortunately, you know, I make no apologies. I mean, we looked into carpet tiles. These carpet tiles that were given to us were older than 7 years old, so there was no off-gassing. And people are sometimes offended by this, but these folks were living in two rooms, and they're a big family, you know? I mean, but AJ, since he went into this house, this guy, his grades at school have just shot through the roof. He has his own bedroom, he has some privacy, and, you know, the downside of this house, Lucy decides that she has to go out and get the right kind of furniture for this house. So you give them a free house, and she goes and puts herself into absolute hell, hellacious debt with the local loan shark to get all the furniture that looks right for the house. So, you know, but she loves the students. This is the bedroom in the tower. It's the kind of drywall job from hell, but it has a beautiful skylight in the top of it she wanted a space to meditate, which was the tornado shelter. And then she wanted to lay in bed and watch the North Star. So that's her. She's very happy. She loves her house. She's the only woman in the world that's got a carpet house. And the only thing that's happened to the carpet is it's shrunk. It's shrunk much more than we expected. So we've had to, you know, in the process of filling a gap underneath that, but it's also faded, and it's kind of beautiful. It's lost some of its color. So at the end, at the end of the year, when our projects are half built, we do our best to roast a pig, which sometimes is successful and sometimes not. And we have a party, and that's a very early photograph of Miss Amy Holtz, I think. But it's an extraordinary experience for the students. I would personally have died for that kind of experience as a student. I mean, it's such an intense, you know, one or 2 year or 18 month experience, and thankfully they hang in with it. And I think Mockbee was—he certainly wasn't a god. You know, he was a genuine kind of southern good old boy, but had a terrific spirit. And we try to keep that spirit and encourage you know, you all to think, you know, naughty thoughts and dirty thoughts. He was a hell of a dreamer. I will finish on one small note. Sambo's youngest daughter, who's very naughty and very much a chip off the old block, was going off to university. All three daughters had gone off to university, and he was very proud of it. And he said to Carol, you know, I want you to have a great time. I want you to get yourself a great education. I want you to party like crazy, get drunk, do drugs, have great sex, all of that stuff. But you dare come home a fucking Republican, and I will. Anyway, that's enough of Mockbee, so thank you very much. That's it.
Thank you, Andrew. Questions? Can we open it up to the floor?
Just perfect, huh?
Their planning regulations. Have they kind of come in since you?
No. I mean, I think everyone has accepted how convenient it all is. You know, this year they've asked us, the conservative town of Greensboro has asked us to redesign the largest park in West Alabama. They've asked us to provide a dog pound for West Alabama, and they've asked us to do a piece of the hospital. So, you know, why not? So it's kind of a marriage of inconvenience, I suppose. It's taken 14 years to get in, because you imagine when he first showed up out there, they just thought it was just a crazy academic with a bunch of hooligans, and they were very suspicious. And the truth behind the success of the project is staying in one place and just hanging in there and being a neighbor and being responsible for your screw-ups. And we have three members of staff who are all local people, and they give me hell if anything goes wrong or the students step out of line. So there's a kind of a tuning fork there to the community that doesn't come right to me, but comes indirectly to me. And that has some value, just staying in one place for a long time, or what feels like a long time. And now they like it. Now they see its potential, and they like to have the kids. I mean, I think some guy showed up that's looking at kind of plotting our survival and suggested that we didn't really understand how much money we bring into the economy, and he calculated it as about $2 million a year. And it's probably right. You have 30 students out there who are buying lunch every day. You have a couple of teachers out there. You're buying these local building materials locally. And so kind of everyone wins, really. Very rarely, everyone has to buy into it. The students have to buy into it. They kind of, the wheels come off if the students decide to leave. The wheels come off if the client decides they're not interested in it. The wheels come off if, the teacher decides to leave. I mean, so everyone has to kind of buy into it. And most, 99% of the time, they have so far. We try and gain their confidence. These staged projects, the multi-year park project, we got them with that pavilion. When the mayor carries a photograph of that pavilion around with him in his pocket, he loves it. I mean, it's like, okay, now what do you all want to do? They don't want us to stop. They want me to do a rope bridge out there next or something. So it's just trust and being there for a long time. And not being, Auburn has a reputation in this area of kind of blow and go. Their academics at Auburn are looking for something to get tenure with. So they go out to West Alabama and do some experiments, work with the catfish industry or the milk industry, and then when they've got tenure, they bugger off back to Auburn and leave these folks high and dry. And we haven't done that, and I think that's given us a lot of credibility. They're not stupid. If it's bringing money to the county, they ain't going to throw us out. They'll put up with us. And I think the older folk actually like the enthusiasm and the life. That you imagine a town of 200 people. Any of the educated kids, they get the hell out of there. They go to Birmingham or they go to a big city, and so suddenly there's 30 transposed kids from a university put in their middle, and there's a little bit of attention. But not much. It's pretty remarkable, really. They all kind of respect each other, or try to.
Mentioning Auburn, I suppose it would be interesting to know a little bit about the dynamic between that group of students and their experiences back at campus. Then, I mean, the second years return to the five-year program, and then the fifth years, for example, people that have done the second year.
We
generally, what's the relation between the campus and the
Well,
no one answers that one.
It's polite. when you get a program like this, you have to put, it becomes your life. I mean, it's what I do. And and it gets a lot of publicity, and suddenly folks at Auburn are kind of jealous of the publicity. That's one aspect of it, but I think that it's a very good part of the school. The school actually has another program which is in an urban situation, so I think the school could actually sell it as being this kind of fantastic polemic. The school itself's very kind of suburban, mm-hmm. so you have this opportunity to kind of give these students this amazing experience. But that the second years when they come out are, I think they either love it or they hate it, and we get a chance. It's a kind of an addition. We look at them and go, well, are we interested in them in the fifth year? You know, because I've got to live with them for a year and a half as well. You get one bad egg and it just becomes a pain in the ass for the whole year. Amy was a classic example. She's now at the AA, can you believe?
No,
oh, she's done. You let her out? Well, at least you come, two of us, huh? So it's a healthy, there is obvious tensions that for whatever reason, it's actually not so easy for me to get to Auburn faculty come out to the Royal Studio. And I don't quite know why, but they should be very proud of their students who are doing incredible things. But maybe I don't make enough phone calls to them inviting them out often enough. I don't know. I mean, you can't win, honestly.
You win in other ways. You don't need to win with them.
Question in the back.
Maybe.
Yeah.
I wonder whether you have ever considered extending the project so that not only students but also, for instance, graduated architects would participate, and also whether you or someone else might have considered to actually extend the project geographically so that it would not only be based in this particular place, but it could be based in other places in Alabama or so on.
Well, I have only so many hours in the day. Actually, at the moment, we do have other students coming into the program, in the outreach program. That is a non-degree certificate program that allows students from all over the world to come. It's limited to 4 or 5 students that come in and help out the mix. It brings older students in. But we're conscious about keeping it as small as possible. If it becomes much bigger, it then takes on a kind of an infrastructure that hinders its kind of spirit, I would suggest. And I'm pretty guarded of that. I don't want to fix something that ain't broke. And, but it's all the time. I mean, because it's small, it puts everyone under undue pressure. We're managing projects that overlap now, whereas 5 years ago we had projects pretty much stopped at summer. And now we've got, 9, 10, 11 projects going on at once, so it stretches all the resources. But there's a definite attempt to keep it small. And I'd be happy for someone else to come and do it somewhere else in Alabama, or somewhere else in the United States of America. I mean, hell, y'all want to come and try it, and I'll give it a go. I think having Mockbee go out into the woods in Alabama was sort of the equivalent of having Frank Gehry go out into the deepest Iowa or somewhere and setting up, because he had such a personality and such a prestige in the South. He had a lot of folks to draw on. So in a sense, he kind of set the thing up in spite of the university. Because these things draw a lot of resources they create good things, but they also create territories which you've got to be always conscious of, and they're a hard thing to deal with sometimes, depending on the personalities. Did that answer your question at all? Not really.
I think for me, what is interesting is what can we come to do to be seen,
the size.
In which the architecture becomes something different.
Yeah, well.
We've maxed out on size. I mean, there are essentially two teachers and 25 students, and that's enough. And you know, it just the complexity of problems we're dealing with now—it's nerve-wracking. So I don't know. I certainly, if you have more, I can't imagine it getting bigger. I think it becomes a different animal then. I think it will become, you know, institutionalized and not be able to be a little bit naughty and do some things that we can do because we're small, you know.
I think people might enjoy hearing, Andrew, the kind of extraordinary effort you make bringing people in there. You mentioned the two teachers, but perhaps that might not communicate to people the fantastic job that you do bringing people from all over.
You mean like you?
I was thinking more of your people from Chicago.
You know, when I showed up at the Royal Studio, Mockbee invited me to come out and help him. And the lovely thing with having Mockbee where was that he kind of floated between the second year and the fifth year. And it was nice to have a superstar to be able to throw in front of the students and make them do some work. Because with me, the kind of respect thing breaks down. I mean, I become one of the team, I become their buddy and all of that stuff. So what I try to do is regularly, you know, invite anyone that's interested to come down and be part of the conversation. And I've actually kind of got a group of people who are down there regularly that kind of get it and get the place and get a feeling for, have a good feel for the place. And it's not necessarily traditional academics, it's people from very different and diverse backgrounds who kind of understand the spirit of it. You know, certainly things can be better. We always aim for the next level, but you kind of understand the limitations of the situation, the expectations of the client, the politics. I mean, it's a fragile infrastructure there. I mean, we're doing a park at the moment where the clients are the county, the city, and the Lions Club organization. And those three organizations have never spoken to each other before, or not for a very long time. And so suddenly we're in this situation where they're making them do, and it's like, my goodness, you all are willing to talk to each other. And you know, one of the politicians stood up the other day and said, I want to do something good in Hale County before I die. And it's like, you want to cry when you hear something like that. And it's just fantastic. So it's a very kind of fragile situation that we live in. And the nice thing with students is a sort of student innocence is that people will forgive them. And there's sort of an unforgiving, there's a forgiveness about it all. But I don't know how the hell I've gotten to that topic. How did it end up there? But no, we get great people like Anderson Inge down there. And he helps us build wonderful bridges. And you need to rehire him and keep hiring him. Because he's a genius. I don't know if you noticed, but that ridge, Anderson Inge.
There's a question in the back.
Picking up on what happens to the students. I think you're giving people an extraordinary educational experience in technical terms. You're also giving them a political and social education they wouldn't otherwise have. I'm really interested in what happens to them later. You've got a throughput now where you've been, you know, there's a whole cycle of quite a lot of people that have been through over a long time. Do they keep in touch with each other? And does that become an important thing in terms of developing an architectural debate in Alabama or in the US about different ways of working? And do they go on to do interesting stuff, which in some ways challenges the norm of mainstream US architecture?
You want to answer that, Amy?
You want me to?
Yeah.
I finished at the Royal Hale Studio in 2001. And then I just finished my master's here in the Environment and Energy program. And I worked for 3 years in big architecture in the US and very corporate architecture. And I think the Rural Studio brought to mind that you're there and you're doing this corporate architecture and nobody really knows and you don't know the clients and there's so much difference between the clients that you're actually working for and those people that you dealt with in the Rural Studio. And I think three years down the line, you know, I thought, oh, this is something I missed was Sambo and everything that he put into our heads and, you know, working with Andrew and thinking about how do you get back to those roots. And then so I came to the AA, and so now I've finished. And I think now I've always got that in my back pocket, and I never want to forget it. And I know that there are a lot of Rural Studio people that have left. You can never forget your experience at the Rural Studio. It's, you know, it's one of those places that stays there forever, even if you're just playing in the mud for a year, you know, because it's a place that you learn a lot just about the building and the understanding of the people and how does architecture relate to the social infrastructure that's there.
For example, are you collaborating with people that you're working with?
I do. I tend to. That's what Gabe would like to do sometime soon. but no, yeah, we do. We keep in touch, and I think, you know, through conversation. But it's only been 4+ years now, and I'm no time ready to start an office on my own. But we do. We keep in touch. People from different teams, and you tend to have a family of Rural Studio, even if you were not even in their class when, you know, they come. I came here and I stayed with somebody who I hardly knew, but she was a Rural Studio grad, and then you talk about ways that you could do other things that might break out to it, you know, and the question is, you know, how does Hook Park become the next one of these Rural Studio type places, and what is the AA going to push towards? That's my question to end my answer.
Any more questions? I think we need to reassure Andrew that we still have a bar in the school upstairs. So for any further questions, please come upstairs and join us for a quick drink up there. Andrew, thank you very much for being here.